Alright, so we should have that written down by now, some words?
Nope.
Should start earlier, here we go. What are you talking about?
Did the bell already ring?
Earlier, a long time ago.
Okay, I never heard it.
You never hear it here. So I'm paying attention to the clock. Okay. So, today we're gonna... The newest stuff about, what we're learning today is really like vocab, so I'm starting off with you writing these vocab words down. A lot of the stuff you're familiar with, you've used functions many times, you just didn't realize it maybe. Okay? So, as we discuss this stuff we're discussing today, and we talk about any of these vocab words, okay, I want you to fill those in with what the definition of these things is. Okay? So, a function. To tell you what a function is, I'm going to use an analogy. Okay. Analogy of a square factory.
Do you want us to draw this?
This is the analogy I'm working with.
What does it make?
That's like a box.
So this is just like a big building, a big factory. Okay? So,
a square.
In here, on this side that we can't quite see, that's where all the trucks come in. Deliver all the stuff that this function is going to use. So this is where
input and output.
All right. So this stuff is coming in here. Whatever that stuff is in there, they take that stuff in this factory, this function. They do stuff to it. Okay. They process it in some way, and they turn all that stuff, that input, into okay. So. The output depends on the input. If I give you give it different inputs, it'll give me different outputs. If this was a factory that made something, like a table or something like that, then if I bring it oak, it makes an oak table. If I bring it pine, it makes a pine table. If I bring a cherry, it makes a cherry table. Right? So the input affects the output. So where's this function? I want you to put a function. There's two pieces to it. Put it as simple as I can put it. It has input and output. And those words, I'm sure that you have heard them used before. Have you heard them used before?
Yeah, we heard about them in like sixth grade.
What is that little,
okay.
Is that I?
That's Roman numeral one. Because this comes in two pieces. So we have input and output. You put something into a function, you get something out. Pretty simple. And we've done that, right? We have lots of functions. We put things into the functions, numbers, right? And we get stuff out of them.
No, we're like using the distributive property because it's like the input of the correct statement and the output is how you change it.
No, there's not really input and output there. It's just a procedure.
Okay.
An example of a function in math would be y equals x plus 1. The input goes, where do you think it goes? Where would you put something into this function? Yeah, typically it's x. We put something in to x. Right.
And so, and the output is the y.
The output is y. Precisely. Coming out of y. Output.
So the input is always the x?
Typically, unless somebody's written it differently, but like 99 times out of 100, yes.
So x.
Now the input could be a and the output is b, and the input could be y and the output is x. It just depends on how it's written. If it's written like this, we're going to input for x. The variable that's by itself is the one we call the output. Grace?
So when something is like, it equals to like an equation thing, that's usually the output?
Yeah, like you're saying it's equal to y?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's usually the output. You should interpret it that way. And if somebody says, well, that's not the output, you should say, well, then it's pretty confusing. You wrote it the way that would imply that this is the output. Okay. So those are the basics. That's the first basic thing about a function. Now here's the other important thing. The second thing. Every input Exactly.
Is this for functions, though?
Mm-hmm. This is the second part of a function. Once we define the second part, that's it for functions. That's what functions are. Okay. Every input has exactly one output. Every input has exactly one output. Okay. This means that if I put something in, something comes out. Right? Can't not come out.
Right.
All right. Also, only one thing comes out. Two things don't come out. Three things don't come out. Just one thing. Okay? That's a function. So if I put something into a thing I think is a function and two things come out, then that's not a function.
What is it?
It would be called a relation.
In that instance. We would use the word relation to say that.
Chris?
Okay.
Go on. Okay. So every input has exactly one output. Right. So this guy right here is a function because everything I put in, I get something out, there's only one way to get a number plus one. If I put in, let me create a table for this one. If the input for this function right here is 2, then what's the output?
3.
If the input is -4, the output is?
-3.
100, output is.
Did
you ever conceive of me putting something in there for x and the input and getting more than one output?
No.
Is it possible that I put something in there but nothing comes out?
No. Actually, yeah, you could do, oh no, because there are zero counts. Or
zero counts as a number. And so, it can have anything put into it and anything could come out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's an example. Let's look at an example of a function. Well, it's not a function, okay? Unless we play with it a little bit. Y equals the square root of x. Here's one example of a non-function. We're not going to dwell on it for very long. I just want you to see that non-functions exist. All right. So tell me, if I give it the input of 4, what would the output be?
2.
Why is the output of this 2?
Because it's the square root of 4.
Okay.
That's what y equals.
So y is the square root of 4, 2?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Why?
How come? How come
it's
2 is the square root of 4?
Because of the symbols.
2 times 2 equals 4.
Because 2 times, that's exactly the precise explanation you would need to give mathematically. Why is the square root of 4 2? Because 2 times 2 is 4. That's the definition of a square root. But here's the thing. If a number multiplies by itself and gives you 4, then it's the square root of 2. Or sorry, the square root of 4, is that right? If a number multiplies, let's put both away, please. If a number multiplies by itself and gives you 4, would you say that's the square root of 4?
No.
No.
Well, actually, yeah, because that'd be the only solution to get 4, 2 times 2.
Yeah.
Because I don't think you can do any other number.
Okay, let me just walk us through this real quick. Why is the square root of 4 2? Because
2 plus times 2 times
2 times itself is 4. Right? Now, if I could say that with any other number, then that would be also the square root of 2, or sorry, the square root of 4, right? If a number can multiply by itself and get 4, then it's the square root of 4, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly the way we explain why 2 is the square root of 4. So, how about negative 2?
Negative 4.
No.
No, see, negative 2 is what's coming out.
So yeah,
is negative 2?
Positive.
What if I multiply negative 2 by itself?
Positive 4.
So is negative 2 the square root of 4?
No.
Why not?
You're confused. I mean, you're not confusing me, but
negative
2
times negative 2 is 4. Yeah.
It doesn't. It could be either. It doesn't matter.
So
if you said like 64, the square root would be 8, and then you could also say negative 8 because negative times negative.
And that's why it doesn't work, because it's those two outputs for one input.
It doesn't work as what?
Because there's more than one output.
Just an example of a thing that looks a lot like a function because it has a y and an x, but it's a non-function because you have two outputs for one input.
Relation.
Okay, is a relation. So this is what we call a relation, not a function.
Is that one a problem? No.
A relation? No. If it looks like a function, but it's not a function because it has multiple outputs, then it's a relation. All right. Now, we won't, like I said, we're not going to worry about this. Because it's not a function, we kind of mess with it and make it into a function. That's for down the road, okay? So this is all just to say non-functions exist. They're out there. Most of the things, if you were to just randomly throw an equation together with y and x in it, I bet you it's a function. Because I bet you whatever you put in, you get something out, and you only get one thing out. Yeah?
Can you solve, like, I don't think this has anything to do with it, but y equals the square root of x? Can you solve that? Oh, because...
You got to have to replace one of those numbers with something. You got to have y or x. It's a, you know, that's why we have systems of equations, because I can't take one equation and solve both variables. One equation, because x and y could be anything. Same is true here. I mean, they have to become special pairs that actually make the equation true, but they could be any. So I need to put a plenty of, now I can solve this, and it's not that hard, because all I have to do is take the square root of 4. Y is that thing. Okay. So let's forget about now the square root of y equals the square root of x. We don't even need to worry about it, because we're just being shown that non-functions happen. They're out there. But most of the things we use each day in a math class, they're going to be functions. So we've got function, right? It's got two parts. It gives you it takes input, it gives you the output. That's the first part. The second part is every input has what?
One output.
One
output.
Output.
Solution. That's what I said.
Well, I'm looking for even more specific than just one output.
One solution.
Not a different word. I want to be more specific. Every input has
an output.
How many outputs?
One. Exactly one.
Does this input? Does this input have one output?
No.
Yes, it does. It has one output. It also has two outputs.
But then that wouldn't be.
Exactly one output is different. Exactly one says not zero, not two, only exactly one. Okay.
What am I doing?
Let's look at Sim's bracelet there. What is that? Would you call it beads?
Yeah.
Does that bracelet have one bead?
No.
Does it not have one bead on it?
Yes, it does.
Does it have more than that?
Yeah.
Yeah, but does it have one?
Yes.
It does. It has more. But
it
also
doesn't have exactly one.
It doesn't have exactly one.
Right.
Okay. That's splitting hairs, I know. An annoying math person thing to do. But when we say exactly, I wrote the word exactly for a reason. Exactly one, not more, and not less. Okay. So how would you define input? It's probably
The input is whatever goes into it.
Input is whatever goes into it. And output, the output is
whatever comes out.
Doesn't need to be any more complicated than that. Functions, the definition of a function is a little bit complicated, but input and output, you know, no surprises there. No surprises there. Let's see, now we're on to domain and range. The domain and range are groups, okay, groups of stuff. Groups of inputs, groups of outputs. Okay.
We didn't do anything for input or output. Oh, I just said going in and going out for
going in and coming out.
Right, and sometimes the way you're familiar with a word, it's fine. We don't have to get real technical. With a function, we have to get a little bit technical. So domain and range. Let's do it this way. I'm going to give you a function. Okay, it's an easy function. We're going to talk about it.
Please no.
Y equals 2x plus 1. Easy function, right?
Yeah.
So here's what I want you to do. I'm just going to kind of section off the rest of this page. Over here, I'm going to ask you to give me an input for the function.
What is it?
X.
Three.
The specific input.
Oh.
Three. Yeah.
Three.
Three, okay, I heard three. So if the input is three, what's the output that goes with that input?
Six.
Seven.
Seven.
Because you have to add
plus
one.
Right? Okay, give me another input.
Four.
Five.
100.
Five.
Okay, 100. Let's get crazy.
101.
201. Give me another input. Yep. Two. Two.
Three.
Why does Clint get
five. Five. Five.
Go for it, Kyler. You could have said an input instead of complaining about Clint. Here, Clint's got another one.
58.
15.
Oh, 58. What's the output for 58?
Oh.
117.
117.
Whoa.
Why even okay, I got this.
You got this.
3,281.
What's the output
for
that one?
It's 6,000.
6,562.
Boom.
6,000.
No,
6,000.
Sorry,
6,000. You cheated. I did not cheat.
You
can use calculator.
Three.
Can
use calculator.
So you can't.
Eat it.
Got one.
Shut up.
You got one, Ethan?
Seven.
Seven.
The
output is
15.
Okay. All right. Let's sort it down. So you get the idea, right?
Yeah.
How long can we do this for?
Ever.
Ever.
Now.
I have a
prison
on my
own.
Poor Sarah.
When we think about the things that we can put into this function, we start to see, like, there's a group of numbers, certain numbers that I can plug into this function, right? That group of numbers is called the domain. The group of the things that you can put into the function is called the domain. All of the inputs you can put into the function is called the domain. Or sometimes just the inputs that we happen to use, okay? The inputs that we happen to use, we can call the domain. Okay? So if I say, let's restrict the domain to these guys here, okay, that's what we call the domain.
Domain, whatever numbers are the inputs.
The whole group that are the inputs.
All the inputs.
Okay. So the other group, the group of outputs, what do you reckon that's called?
Range.
So is range.
Range.
So is range the group of outputs? Yes.
Wait, group of all inputs. The output numbers.
Range is outputs, domain is inputs.
Oh, I got that.
It's a good time to figure out if you got that mixed up.
So
the domain is just a big grouping of numbers, the numbers that you can or actually do plug into the function. And the range is the numbers that you could get out or that you do get out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's say we take the same function. And without... So here, let me just review here. The domain in this case, since I gave you specific examples, the domain is the numbers... 3,200, 258, 3,281, and 7. That's the domain. If I asked you what the domain was, you could write it in a list with commas in between. You're just telling me exactly what the group is.
What happens if the y was like a something?
Well, look at the y in just a second.
I'm
looking at the x's.
Son of a
I see some confusion. So let me just shrink this down a bit.
Well, I just.
What?
I don't know. I'm just.
Definition in words, we could say that the domain is the set, right? You know the word set. If you have, periodically McDonald's gives away toys with their Happy Meals, right?
But you have to pay for it at the Happy Meal. So you're not getting anything.
I'm not starting that discussion. What I'm saying is, when you go up to the counter, you see. Right, a display with all of the toys.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And if you collected all the toys, you'd have the whole set.
Oh,
right? That group.
You'd be a
whole
like Donald Trump.
So the set.
What is that?
Grace
out in the hall.
Wasting words.
I'm gonna have people start just standing in the hall because they're disrupting the class. I like the little chirp chat sometimes, a little joking and laughing, and that's great, but it can just be too much. So try not to let it be too much. Liz, an example of too much set of all the inputs. So a function has a domain, and the domain is just a set of all the inputs. Okay. Now, the domain can be defined a little bit differently depending on the situation. In this situation, I told you specific, or you, not even tell you, you told me specific numbers to put into the function, right? We listed them out, some specific examples of things we put into the function. So, like, if I were to ask you about this function with this table, this particular table, and I said, what is the domain? The answer would look like, squiggly bracket. You know what a squiggly bracket is? You draw a nice little pointy thing.
Doesn't that mean like that's the output?
This squiggly brackets are used differently in math. When you see two squiggly brackets like this, it means that what's inside of these brackets is a set. That's set notation. Anyway, the set of inputs is 3, 100, 2, 58. comma 3281, comma 7. That's the set of all of the inputs that we use. Okay. Replace this word with outputs.
No.
You have range. Set of all the outputs.
Wait.
If I were to ask you, what's the range of this function with this table? What would it be?
7.
All of the outputs. 7. 201, 5, 117, 6,563, and 15.
Exactly. Set all the inputs. Now that's when we have specific examples. Okay. Look, there's a table with inputs and outputs. That's what the domain and range is for that situation. But if we don't have a table, if we don't have specific examples of inputs and outputs, then, well, the domain and range are a little broad. Without being told like specific numbers that you're going to put into this function, just leaving it open to whatever you want, well, at whatever's possible for the function, then your legs under your desk. Just here, you go stand up. You haven't told me what specifically the values are that we're going to plug in for x. We're just leaving it wide open, right? So we're just asking, like, what's possible? What's possible to plug in for x?
Anything.
How do we say that in a math way? Like, you have to
infinite,
say...
Infinite.
There's an infinite supply of numbers.
A number 8 that's sideways.
No.
Okay.
That's infinity somewhere.
That would imply that the domain is a number called infinity, which infinity is not a number. How do I tell you all the numbers that this function can have as input? But in words, we're going to try to use words.
So,
okay, I got this.
All
so
the numbers,
right here,
as in to stand for all the original number.
Okay, there is a symbol that means what we're after right now, actually.
Okay, I got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so domain, you could go and say you can use an infinite amount of numbers.
Which numbers?
Any number.
Oh, can you just say 0 x?
Can. Oh, good. All right, so now we're getting to something. X can be 0 through...
Then...
But it could be negative 2.
Yeah, we're kind of getting there. We're kind of getting more specific. Here we're trying to... Put it into language.
Okay, so I don't even know what this symbol means, but I just provided it. It's like a little zero line through. What does that mean anyway? It's not right.
I thought that was that tower.
It's not right because.
No, I mean like there's one. It's, yeah.
Yeah.
What is that?
This is the Greek letter theta.
What? I thought focus on that in this maps testing or something.
Probably did, because theta is used a lot in math and science to represent an angle.
Oh, okay. So, then I'm not completely
stupid. No, not at all.
This
okay, Kyler, come on, yeah. Give it a try again. X can't be any
anything?
Any
number?
What kind of thing? Number, okay, any number.
I thought we were gonna write these numbers.
You could.
Can you just say the negative thingamajigger?
The negative thingamajigger?
Yeah, that thing.
To the positive thingamajigger?
Yeah. That's infinity.
You can say that. From negative infinity to positive infinity, there's no limits on it. Sure, that works too.
Okay.
Here's the more concise math way to say it. X can be any, but it has to be specific, real number. There's no limits on what X can be, except for we want X to be two. A non-real number. Which you probably don't.
X can, fake
so X can be, domain can be any real number?
Right, the set of all real numbers, that's the set, that's the domain. So here's an even more concise way to say it. This symbol here, it's an R with two vertical posts.
So real numbers?
This guy right here, if you see it, what it's saying is all real numbers.
How does that make that out?
How does what make what?
How does that make that out? Make the real number.
It's just a symbol we use to represent a set of numbers called the real numbers. There's different numbers. You got the integers, you got the whole numbers, you got rational numbers, irrational numbers, and they all have their own symbols. This one is all the real numbers. What's that? Yes? Well, it's that's a fair name for it, but it's not called a fake number, it's called an imaginary number. And this is the basis of the imaginary numbers.
What is that?
The square root of negative 1.
Well, can't you do something
to
find that?
Is it 1? It's the square root of negative 1.
It's imaginary.
Oh, well, you can't do anything to find that.
It's 1. Negative.
Wait, this is awesome.
Right. That's why it's a new kind of number called the imaginary number. But we won't worry about it.
So all negatives are imaginary numbers?
The square roots of negative numbers are imaginary numbers.
Mm-hmm. Wait, so math is not confused yet?
There are gaps. The domain of this function is all real numbers because x could be anything. Now what could y be?
Anything as well. Oh no, it could be anything that the domain
makes. Any real number.
Now can it? Could I conceivably make, if I found the right x, could I make y, here, let me like draw this. If I were to plug in the right x, could I get a y of like 3.746?
Yeah, because you have infinite.
Yeah, if I find just the right x, it will make 3.746, right?
Right.
So I can get 3.746, I can also get any other number, really, positive or negative, fraction or decimal. So what's the range for this function?
The same.
It's the same. Also all real numbers. In that right hand, let's put it in pencil.
Can you want me to write this out? I mean,
I'm writing it up here.
I'm not
this is what I feel. I didn't say that your limit, your note should be limited to these vocab words. Okay, so the domain here, x could be anything, it could be any real number. The range y also could be anything, any real number. Is an example of a function? That's not the case. Right, here it comes. Y equals x squared.
Y?
You guys have messed with this function a little bit already. You put in a number, you square that number until the function works.
Okay. So, give an example.
But wouldn't that be the same process, go? Because we still get a number.
So the x, if we put in,
wouldn't that be the same
100.
As what we were just doing? Because you're just putting in a number and then, like, mixing it with whatever.
And getting out a number. Yeah, this is a function. It's just that the domain and range are not necessarily exactly the same as the one we just did.
So what happens if you put in 10 for that?
What happens if you put in 10? Well, the input is the x, right?
Y
so we'll 100. Input 10 and the output would be, yes, 100, 10 times 10.
Okay, but we
have,
I guess.
I'll put a million in.
Okay,
but wouldn't
well,
there be infinite solutions then?
A million.
Not if you put in 0.
A million times a million.
Is a billion.
It's a trillion.
Oh, that's how much the lottery's worth.
No, it's a billion times trillions.
Did somebody actually win?
Yeah.
Three people.
Can you buy a ticket?
How can three people win in some water?
Math teacher.
They just get screwed.
Dude, you could get lucky. You could just, like, burn this place to the ground.
One, 1 million times a million, a trillion, right? Okay? Whatever you put in for x, you square it.
So many zeros.
How come it feels like you're going to take a break on the hallway pretty soon.
Yeah, how come they don't want to take a break?
All right. So, what can the domain be? What can x be?
The R thing? I don't know what you call it.
We all agree to that?
Yeah, what do you call that?
Kind
of
call
it the double R.
Call it R.
You, when I try to say this, I say, instead of all real numbers.
Okay.
But
all real numbers.
But so couldn't the range be all real numbers?
No.
Would this be in our homework? Like, questions about could this equation work?
About the domain and range?
Yeah.
Wait, we're having homework?
Yeah.
No.
Alright. Domain is all real numbers. Can I square two? It's two squareable. Can I square that? Can I plug into this function?
Yeah.
Can I square negative 4?
Yeah.
Positive numbers, negative numbers. Can I square fractions?
Yeah.
Decimals?
Yeah.
Anything is squareable.
Anything.
Well, let's look at the range.
Ugh.
Nope. Cross it out. What could the range be? What values can I get out of this function?
Ah, right here.
Double R.
Double R, double R.
B, double E, double R, even.
It could just be any real number that is not the domain, unless the domain equals the range.
Yeah, something like 1 or 0, right? 1 squared is 1, 0 squared is 0.
Any
real number.
So 0 a real number?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Because I learned, like, in it's not an integer, so I thought integers were real numbers.
So, any, is that right? Is that any real number?
Question mark.
Uproarious applause for the first person who can think of something that you cannot get out of this function.
Me.
Infinity.
Zero.
Oh, wait.
Infinity.
Infinity is not a number, so it's not really.
Well,
a
I got
this. You gotta tell me a number that you cannot get out
it's
of this function.
It's negative 1.
Can you get negative 1 out of this function?
Yes.
Okay, tell me that.
1 negative 0.
Tell me.
Oh, no.
Tell me the number I would put in to get out negative 1.
1.
Negative.
You can't.
You can't at all.
Wait, what do I get again?
Uproarious applause. So let's uproarious
applause. Hold on,
come on. Bring it up.
I was just thinking like regular not square, but.
Oh, non-square numbers.
Yeah, because, yeah, okay.
You can get a non-square number by squaring a non-square, like a, not a whole number, like a decimal number. So all positive numbers in zero. So you see how different functions will have different domains and ranges.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, Kyler?
Give me back my hotel.
Let's take a second.
He took my pencil.
You could ask for it back without being so disruptive.
I did. I was like, can I please have back anything to back?
And then
he's
like,
so then I had to raise my voice and I said I had to kill him.
Yeah, so sometimes the domain or the range will be just like, hey, anything goes, and sometimes it'll be like, well, no, not everything goes. There's limitations on what we can do here. Okay, we can't get a negative number, we square a number, so the range has to be different. It has to be all positive numbers and zero.
But didn't you say any real numbers from the range could be two?
Two is a positive number.
No.
Yes, it
is. Can't the range be any real number?
No.
No.
Any real number includes...
Not on
for a different function. The domain is what we can put in. In this function, we can put in anything. In this function, the range, well, the range is always what you can get out. In this function, we can get anything out of the function. But in this one, while we can put any number into the function for x and square it, we cannot get absolutely anything out of the function. Like, we can't get negative numbers. It's impossible to get a negative number by squaring some number, right? At least by squaring a real number.
Right.
Okay. Maybe this is a good division line to draw here on some of these things and pick the rest up.
What
tomorrow.
Lesson is this?
We're not here tomorrow.
This is 5.1. 5.1 is where we are.
Mainstream like school.
I don't care about your.